who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 100 years later, the Negro still is not free. 100 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 100 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 100 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds himself in exile in his own land. And so we've come here today to dramatize a shameful condition. In a sense, we've come to our nation's capital to cash a check. When the architects of our republic wrote the magnificent words of the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence, they were signing a promissory note.
I guess even though we were free, we were still slaves in the mind.
Message!
When you stood on the Lincoln Memorial that day in August, 63, and you said, I had a dream, did that dream envision that you could see a war in Asia preventing the federal government doing for the Negroes, preventing the society doing for the Negroes, that which you think had to be done?
No, I didn't envision that then. I must confess that that period was a great period of hope for me. And I'm sure for many others all across the nation, many of the Negroes who had about lost hope, saw a solid decade of progress in the South. And in 1954, which was, 64, 1963, 9 years after the Supreme Court's decision to be in the March on Washington, meant a great deal. It was a high moment, a great watershed moment. But I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now, I'm not one to lose hope. I keep on hoping. I still have faith in the future. But I've had to analyze many things over the last few years, and I would say over the last few months. I've gone through a lot of soul-searching and agonizing moments, and I've come to see that we have many more difficult days ahead, and some of the old optimism was a little superficial, and now it must be tempered with a solid realism. And I think the realistic fact is that we still have a long, long way to go, and that we are involved in a war on Asian soil, which, if not checked and stopped, can poison the very soul of our nation.
Dr. King, even if there had not been a war in Asia, would you still not have had this nightmare insofar as the Negro movement for equality then touched on two things that the white community holds sacred, their children and their property?
Oh, I have no doubt that we would have encountered great difficulties, great problems of resistance if the war had not been in existence, so that I'm not going to say that all of our problems would be solved if the war in Vietnam is ended, but I do say that the war makes it infinitely more difficult to deal with these problems. When a nation becomes obsessed with the guns of war, it loses its social perspective, and programs of social uplift suffer. This is just a fact of history, so that we do face many more difficulties as a result of the war. It's much more difficult to really arouse a conscience during a time of war. I noticed the other day, some weeks ago, a Negro was shot down in Chicago, and it was a clear case of police brutality. That was on page 30 of the paper, but on page 1 at the top was 780 Viet Cong killed. That is something about a war like this that makes people insensitive. It dulls the conscience. It strengthens the forces of reaction. And it brings into being bitterness and hatred and violence. And it strengthened the military-industrial complex of our country. And it's made our job much more difficult, because I think we can go along with some programs, if we didn't have this war on our hands, that would cause people to adjust to new developments, just as they did in the South. They said they'd never ride the bus with us, blood would flow in the streets, they wouldn't go to school, and all of these things. But when people came to see that they had to do it because the law insisted, they finally adjusted. And I think white people all over this country will adjust once the nation makes it clear that in schools and housing, we've got to learn to live together as brothers. I think the biggest problem now is that we got our gains over the last 12 years at bargain rate, so to speak. It didn't cost the nation anything. In fact, it helped the economic side of the nation to integrate lunch counters and public accommodations. It didn't cost the nation anything to get the right to vote established. And now we are confronting issues that cannot be solved without costing the nation billions of dollars. Now, I think this is where we are getting our greatest resistance. They may put it on many other things, but we can't get rid of slums and poverty without it costing the nation something.
Peace, 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 kings and queens. I ain't gonna be with y'all long. Rest in peace, Martin Luther King. You had a dream. It turned into a nightmare. We all understand that. We all go through that. Martin Luther King, from the top of my heart, you showed everyone what it was to be a peaceful protester. And that doing peaceful protests will get you more than where you are now. You got them to change a lot. You got them to change a lot. At the same time, you gave your speech of the dream that you had. Throughout that whole time, as you gave that speech, you were walking that dream in reality that you had. When you started to wake up from the dream, you started to realize that the dream that you had and that you were still having was a nightmare. Once you broke free from that nightmare, they didn't want you no more. Because once you broke free from that nightmare, you had the power to break your people free. To wake your people up. That's why they got rid of you, Martin. Your work is important to us, and we'll never forget it. That nightmare that you want us to wake up from, we're still trying to wake up from. Some of us woke up. Others are too far gone. And the ones in the middle are still fighting. Martin Luther King, we're going to keep fighting and waking up from the dream. What you started, we want to finish. If it's not in my lifetime, it's going to be in the lifetimes after me. This is J World, the House of Conscious Drama, Roundtable Discussions. Happy Black History Month. Let's educate each other. this time.